give her some company over here. I mean, sorry. And happy Memorial Day weekend to you. I know it has been it's been a very challenging week in a lot of ways for a lot of us. But this morning we are going to we're just going to praise the goodness of God and His faithfulness. So would you stand?
Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me. Just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Let's sing, I will believe.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus.
I will believe.
power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus.
First Chronicles 16:30-31, we read, worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice, and let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns.
Though we walk through the shadow of death, you will not forsake us. Though we fall, in your arms we find rest. You will never fail us. You go before us, behind us. Yes, you are the one who saves. You strong to save us, and by your word you will light every sin. You are ever faithful, Jesus. You are ever faithful. You go before us, behind us. Yes, you waiting. The same God who's never late is working. joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will. I choose to pray. Choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can
sing that again. I choose
to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the
Chronicles 29, 10 through 11. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, Praise be to you, Lord, the God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you, oh. Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. It's your breath. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath.
In our lungs, Lord, and we choose to glorify you. No matter what we felt like coming here, no matter like what our week was like, it is you we choose to glorify. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence this morning. And Lord, as we partake in our message this morning, Lord, we pray that you would open our hearts and our minds, Lord, that we would listen to your words and they would have an effect in our heart. We praise you again. In your name we pray, amen. Jesus, amen. Welcome, Lakeview family, my brothers and sisters in the Lord. Before you have a seat, I would like you to take a look around, find somebody new. Nice try, Milton. Shake a hand, welcome them this morning as our kids are released. All right, here I am like a teacher telling the class, okay, it's time to simmer down now. All right. It's good to see everybody this morning, and a special welcome if you're a visitor with us. If this is your first time, there are connection cards that we have if you'd like to fill one out. If you didn't get one on the way in and you weren't accosted by one of our greeters, they have one for you if you want to get some more information about our church. Welcome this morning. We have a special speaker this morning. Pastor Brian is away with his family. But we have somebody very dear to our hearts. I'm going to welcome Pastor Milton. He's going to come up and speak with us. I'm going to just give you a word of prayer before you start, if you don't mind. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would speak mightily through Milton. Lord, that he would be just a vessel for the words you have for him, and he would pour out your heart to us this morning. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. I know how you're feeling today. You're expecting Tom Brady to play, but then they throw in Joe Flacco, or they throw Tyrod Taylor or Zach Wilson. So I'm sorry, you'll have to put up with me today. So welcome, everybody. Happy Memorial Day weekend to you. If you are serving as a military veteran, I salute you today. And thank you for your service on this Memorial Day. These are really, really interesting times these days, and I wanted us to just try to focus here this morning. Our passage this morning is found in Acts chapter 2. I've entitled this message, Embrace Vintage Pentecost Revival. Embrace Vintage Pentecost Revival. We're found that we're looking at Acts chapter 2 in verses 21, 37 to 41. My wife Tammy is here with us today, and we'll talk to you later on if you have any questions. We have a ministry also called True North Youth Ranch, where we use horses to work with teens and children. So if you want some information, you can talk to my wife about that today. This message has been boiling in me for some time now, especially as we look at the news and things that are going on in our world. I sat and watched the TV and wondered, God, what can happen to change the tide in our world today, in our nation? And this topic, it just kept coming into my heart regarding Pentecost revival. And so we're looking at Acts chapter 2. We're starting at verse 14 because I'll make a summary of the first 13 verses. And it says this: Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last day, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people, and your sons and daughters will prophesy, and your young men will see visions, your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Jumping down now to verse 37, Peter preaches his sermon, talks about Jesus and his resurrection, and he talks about King David. He goes now in verse 37, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And the promise is for you and your children and all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to the number that day. In his book, Seasons of Refreshing, Evangelism and Revivals in America, Keith J. Hardman defines revival this way. The words revival or awakening may be defined as the restoration of God's people under a period of indifference and decline. And there are two main thrusts, he says, in this definition. He says that there is a conversion or salvation of a number of unbelievers and the reestablishment of biblical truth so that the church is built up and empowered for the work of God in the lost and dying world. You would think that this book was written during the national pandemic's lockdown. No, it was written in the 1990s, and the definition is still viable for today. The definition spurs on the following questions for us to reflect on. How dark does our world need to get for us to realize that it's time for the local church and the church universal to shine blazingly bright for Jesus Christ? How oppressive does the domain of Satan need to be for us to realize that true freedom in Jesus Christ is in our grasp right now for the world and the body of Christ to experience? How dead do souls need to be for the church to realize that our world needs a vintage Pentecost awakening for today, right here and right now? We live in an era where numerous people in our world have been made to feel physically, emotionally, and spiritually hopeless and overcome. But who can blame them? The tsunami of COVID is still lurking with 1 million dead to its credit here in this nation. The war and terrorism on the people of Ukraine appears never ending. On TV, we have seen the sufferings of millions of Ukrainians. American cities are overrun by crime with shoddy, non-existent prosecution. Mass shootings continue in unsuspecting towns, schools, and neighborhoods, turning lives upside down and changing families forever. Many seek for solace, questioning to fulfill every desire and need via all media venues, deepening an already hemorrhaging lack of human interaction. Our schools have lost their focus of teaching children and appearing committed to redefining human identity. Federal, state, and local governments on both sides of the aisle seek for power in deciding what social norms and laws will be the law of the land. In addition, many, even Christians, are looking to other religions to palliate their stress and to try to escape via mystical meditation and philosophy or the like, because they rebel against the notion of there being only one way to God, and that is Jesus Christ. We are often left to wonder if God will answer prayer for revival, or will he allow us enough rope to collective humanity to hang itself? Please forgive these seemingly hopeless scenarios, but we can all agree that a Holy Spirit-driven wind of change is needed in our society and in our nation and in our world. The Bible confirms that God still desires for millions to experience the limitless power of the Holy Spirit and his life-changing grace. And this is still the order of the day. His grace still extends today, but it's not going to be extending forever. There will be a time when God's grace will be over and the time of judgment will come. Or perhaps we are satisfied that our prayers for revival have become short-sighted, spent on ourselves solely or just simply out of gas, literally and figuratively. Lakeview, I want to encourage us today, and as I say this, I'm saying this to myself today as well. Let's embrace vintage Pentecost revival. It's a matter of life and breath, the breath of the fresh wind of the Holy Spirit. Let's embrace vintage Pentecost revival. It's a matter of life and breath, the breath of the fresh wind of the Holy Spirit. This past Thursday was Ascension Thursday, usually celebrated on a Thursday, marking 40 days after Easter when Jesus ascended into heaven, and today is Ascension Sunday, is when they celebrate Ascension Thursday. We are not confused this morning. However, next Sunday, and I had asked Pastor Brian before he left if it was okay to preach on this passage, because I don't know if he was going to touch upon the subject next week. But next Sunday, June 5th, is Pentecost Sunday. And we all heard of the title and the event before. Pentecost meaning 50 days, the time when Israel would celebrate the Exodus from Egypt. From Passover to Pentecost is 7 weeks or 49 days. For the New Testament, we see that Jesus spent 40 days of post-resurrection appearances. And before his ascension, Jesus says in Luke 24, verses 49 and 53, and if you look at Acts chapter 1, verses 4 to 11, he says, "And behold, I'm sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Going down, he says that while he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven, and they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple praising God. Mark's gospel states that the disciples preached everywhere while the Lord worked with them and confirmed the message by accompanying signs, it says in Mark chapter 16, verse 20. Sources say that these 120 Christ followers mentioned in Acts chapter 1, verses 14 to 15, may have spent time in a place called the Temple Mount Colonnade, a place connected to the temple that had more than three floors to it, waiting for the Holy Spirit. There were manifestations present at the arrival of God's Holy Spirit. And let me just summarize, because we, like I said, we didn't read verses 1 to 13. realize that these manifestations were a surprise to everyone. Even the disciples, though obediently waiting, did not know the form in which the promised Holy Spirit would come. Peter is the main speaker, but I'm sure that there is some bewilderment as to the miraculously otherworldly entrance taken by the Holy Spirit. We read that passage when he says, no, we're not drunk. This is the coming of the Spirit of God. That's not how he said it. He didn't say it in such a formal way. I'm sure he said, no way. I didn't know this was going to happen this way. These guys really are not drunk, but they are being filled with the Spirit of God. It's the promise being fulfilled. The text reads, suddenly from heaven, a sound like a mighty, violent, rushing wind, filling the whole house. Divided tongues as fire, it says in verse 19, resting on each one. And like I said in Acts chapter 1:15, verse 15, about 120 present, plus to the 12 disciples included. But take note that prior to this manifestation, the Holy Spirit worked through, was with, was on the people of God. Now he would fill the believer, he would seal the believer, and now he will dwell inside of the believer. Those gathered began to speak with other tongues, other dialects, as the Holy Spirit empowered, enabled them in verse 4. Imagine Mary, who's listed there among the 120, Jesus' earthly mother, and his brothers experiencing this monumental coming of God's Holy Spirit. These gathered spoke in unlearned Holy Spirit-equipped language, a dialect, specifically for native-born people from those countries to hear the message clearly. If you were to count the nations, there are about 16 dialects that are listed. The hearing crowd was mixed, but who were God-fearing Jews from surrounding regions in the area, Acts chapter 2, verse 5. But there was no confusion as to the message spoken. God's idea of his kingdom was present. They spoke of the mighty works of God, it says. And Peter preached a whole sermon explaining why these manifestations were happening. By his sermon, we can get the feeling that Peter's whole sermon is not recorded, just the important parts of it. Peter was encouraging his audience to not overlook or miss the reason why the Holy Spirit was manifested in these ways. I'm praying that we will see the need today to embrace Pentecost revival today, because it's a matter of life and breath, the fresh breath and wind of the Holy Spirit to blow through our nation, in our churches, in our schools, in our governments, and in our streets today. I truly believe that there are unchangeable certainties found in our passages of Acts and Joel that remind us, the church, the body of Christ, that God is not finished with revival and in making sure that the gospel is communicated to all nations. Which leaves us the task today of how we're to embrace this vintage Pentecost revival. You guys ready? You're not sleeping on me this morning, right? That happens all the time with me. So I want to make sure that we're checking in on you, that you are not falling asleep. I think the first way to embrace this vintage Pentecost revival is by understanding that it was specifically unmistakable. We see this in verses 17 and 18. The passage that we didn't read today was the prophecy of Joel, chapter 2, verses 28 and following. Their waiting for the promise was over. Peter, quoting the prophet Joel, states that in these last days, and the question we have to ask in this part of the passage is, when did the counting of the last days begin? It is considered the period between Jesus' first and his second coming is considered the last days. We see that Jesus spoke of events that would happen in the last days in Matthew 24, in Mark 13, and in Luke 21. The Apostle Paul also wrote as if he was living in the last days. If you were to read the letters of 1 and 2 Thessalonians, you will see this. But perhaps more poignantly, this outpouring of the Holy Spirit highlights the last days. The prophet Joel does not mention the phrase in the last days, but he mentions the day of the Lord in his prophecy. But he speaks of a future day when Israel will be redeemed from their troubles. The end times is demonstrated by miraculous signs during Jesus' ministry until the second coming of Christ. For many, that is a problem because many believe that the miracles of that time have ended and no longer continue to these days. But the Holy Spirit was to be poured out upon all flesh, as it says in the prophet Joel. This term poured out is not the first time this shows up in Scripture. The Greek word ektheo means I will pour out. The emphasis is the source and the receiver. God is pouring out his Holy Spirit on his followers, like the latter rain referenced in Joel chapter 2, verse 23. And it's not a little sprinkle, it's not a little spritz, it's a downpour of the movement and presence of his Holy Spirit. Some translations say that it will be poured out on all flesh. We can just say poured out on humanity, on people, people groups, families, and ancestry. In our prophetic passage of Joel, the date and time of the passage is still in question. However, Peter labels the fulfillment of his prophecy being accomplished on the day of Pentecost, accomplished in Peter's historical present. So what was prophesied in the past was now coming to fruition. Other passages describing an outpouring, for instance, are found in Ezekiel chapter 39, verse 29, where he says, the Holy Spirit was poured out on the house of Israel. Ezekiel chapter 43, verses 1 to 5, the presence of God fills the temple with supernatural manifestations of his arrival. Excuse me. Ezekiel 47, 1 to 12, the water flows from the threshold of the temple, filling the temple, and the prophet measures it, filling up first ankle deep, then knee deep, then waist deep, and to a point where he had to swim in this water, the water bringing life wherever it went. Once the disciples and all present were filled in, by, and with the Holy Spirit, the message of the gospel would rock the government's present. It was specifically unmistakable, the coming of the presence of God. You guys are still with me, right? Because we're looking at a second way to embrace this vintage Pentecost revival. And the second way to embrace this is that cause an uproar reverberating through the kingdom's present that day. Now, I have to admit that we have to go symbolic here and metaphoric to fit this in the passage. Taking a symbolic and metaphoric look at this idea, it says that wonders in heaven and signs on the earth below in verse 19. Primarily, this outpouring would shake the political religious establishments of their day in verses 17 and 18. The first converts to Christianity were of different genders. They were sons and daughters, different generations, young men and old men, and different socioeconomic status. Even male and female servants in the Greek is called slaves will be filled with God's Holy Spirit. There were the rich, the poor, those who were slaves, and those in government positions that were directly changed by this outpouring. And how we need that outpouring today to flow into the government and streets and schools of our nation. And it says here that they would dream dreams. This phrase is the first and only time it's mentioned in Acts and in the New Testament. And this dream means it's a vision of recurring over while one sleeps. They will see visions. This is a sense of sight while one is awake, a supernatural sight of vision. Today, in our very century, many Muslims in Christian hostile countries today are coming to faith in Jesus Christ because some are having visions of Jesus manifesting himself to them and telling them of his salvation. Prophesying talks about speaking forth the word and counsel of God and the Holy Spirit anointing and inspiration. These are the manifestations. And it was a manifestation of the power of God in its unique way. When the Holy Spirit arrived, there was a clash of kingdoms. The kingdom of God had already been on the move through the ministry of Jesus Christ and his disciples, but now was on full display when the Holy Spirit came on the scene. It was the word of God coupled by the presence of God and manifested in the power of God. I would propose that it was reminiscent of the shaking of the Egyptian and of the Egyptian kingdom and its polytheistic vestiges. Remember that they were celebrating Pentecost, and just 50 days before they were doing Passover. And in the mind of every Jewish person there, the Exodus from Egypt was etched on the history of their minds and on the Jewish people. It's why these Jews were in Jerusalem. The 10 plagues sent by God were directed to Egyptian gods, and the 10th plague of the killing of the firstborn attacked the worship of Pharaoh's son as a god. And it's interesting that Acts talks about the sun and the moon being affected. The Egyptians had a god, Ra, who was the sun god, and the moon god, Cruza. But that's just me picking into a stray of hall, right? Of course, present were the Roman and Jewish governments, including religious leaders. Roman governors were from a polytheistic or belief in many gods, an idolatrous background. Rome itself loosely had moral practices sprinkled in every aspect of society. The Rome governed over the mainly Jewish city of Jerusalem that for generations was governed by King Herod's family tree, raised on the law of Moses. Little did anyone know that the disciples were sitting on a spiritual keg of dynamite that was about to blow through all the social political layers that we just listed. I would also suggest that the coming of the Holy Spirit would threaten the kingdom of the heavenly places, the abode of demonic forces. Jesus demonstrated this in his ministry. The Greeks believed in a three-layered heaven, seeing it as the heavens or the heavenly places. The Hebrews saw it as a seven-layer storehouse of heaven. But the Greeks believed that where the first heaven was where the clouds and the birds were found, the second layer was where the stars and the planets were, and the third would be where God and his and the invisible hosts of heaven were, including the demonic forces. In the book of Job, Satan goes into God's presence and in this heaven part that we see. In addition, Jesus stated after his disciples returned from preaching and healing and casting out demons and teaching, he says in Luke chapter 10, verses 17 to 19, the 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." He replied, "I saw Satan fall from like lightning from the heavens." Understanding that one can argue that we're not told when Jesus saw this occurring. He could have seen it happen during creation when Satan rebelled. Or while the disciples ministered in the authority of Jesus Christ, the kingdom of darkness was shaken. It is why Satan fights for his turf today. God is also recorded as saying that he would shake heaven and earth in Haggai chapter 2, verse 6. The writer of Hebrew records sort of the same message as he describes God's unshakable kingdom affecting all the other shakable kingdoms in Hebrews chapter 12. But I think, folks, that even more than these, the personal kingdoms enshrined in the lives of those God-fearing Jews was shaken and affected by the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I appreciate what Dr. Charles H. Kraft, professor emeritus of anthropology at Fuller Theological Seminary. He also is a speaker and writer on spiritual warfare and deliverance ministry. He wrote of the following three areas of one's life that are challenged when confronted and encountered by the presence of the Holy Spirit in his article, Three Encounters in Christian Witness. Perhaps these were confronted when you and I came to faith in Jesus Christ. And if you have not yet received Jesus as your Savior, as your leader, as your Lord, these areas probably remain arrested by the kingdom of darkness. And the first area is that their allegiances and loyalties were confronted by the Spirit of God. Why? Because the Spirit of God wanted to rescue them from wrong relationships and bring them into the right relationship with Jesus Christ. Their truth was confronted by the Holy Spirit. There was a truth encounter that occurred. Why? To counter their ignorance or error, to bring them to correct understandings about Jesus Christ. And how interesting that today we live in a society that encourages us to speak our own truth. Their power systems were confronted by the power of the Holy Spirit. Why? To release people from satanic captivity and bring them into freedom in Jesus Christ. Kingdoms were shaken that day by the Spirit of God. And probably at the sound of my voice, and those of you who are watching through Zoom and so on, you have been wrestling with these kingdoms in your life. You have been needing an allegiance encounter. You've been loyal to one person or to one thing and have been struggling to be allegiant and have loyalty to Jesus Christ. Maybe you're believing certain truths in your life that you've been having difficulty to accept the truth of the gospel of Christ. And perhaps maybe you are needing a power encounter where your life is bound by demonic forces and needing the liberation of the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe that the Lord Jesus Christ, when the Spirit of God came, there were kingdoms that were confronted that day. But lastly, you know when a minister says lastly, it's not really the last thing. But I promise you we'll race to the lastly here. Let's embrace this vintage Pentecost revival that emphasized the countdown to Judgment Day. Now is when we take this second half of the passage literally. It didn't happen at that time as Peter's preaching, but there will be a cosmic dismantling of the whole solar system and that of the earth. This, as I said, has not yet fully been accomplished. Arrogant politicians and scientists have championed the notion that our world will come to an end because of climate change. I will stand here and say that I agree that we have not been good stewards of our planet. I'm trying my best to be a good recycler of bottles because I can use those bottles to get something else. That's my contribution to our society in this area. But we have also behaved in ways that will ultimately be met with a God-sized reckoning. I respectfully compare 9/11 to a toppling of the classic Lincoln Logs compared to what awaits our world at Jesus' second coming. Acts chapter 2, verse 18 reminds us of blood, fire, and billows of smoke. In the prophecy of Joel, it talks about war, and these are the times when it talks about the blood of people rolling in the streets. But along with the cosmic dismantling of the solar system and of the earth, I believe that there will also be a cosmic dismantling of God's demonstration of grace. The people, it says, and responded in verses 37 to 41. It says that their hearts were cut, they were pierced, they were convicted, and they asked the instructions, what must we do? I find it interesting that in Joel chapter 2, verse 32, that it says that those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And it says, for on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, there will be deliverance as the Lord has called. Interesting that on Jerusalem that day, the Mount Zion is the temple there, that salvation came for 3,000 people. They were given the way to new life in Jesus Christ in verses 38 to 39. And the promise of the Holy Spirit, it says, is for all far and near who call on the name of the Lord for salvation. Church, we're called to embrace vintage Pentecost revival. And what does embracing vintage Pentecost revival look like for us today? As the people responded, what must we do? I was saying myself that in months before this message came into fruition, as I watched TV, God, what must I do for you to use me to bring vintage Pentecost revival to our society? And I think I have a little list here to hopefully make it practical for us today. Number one, be surrendered to God's rule and reign over our lives. Surrender to God's Holy Spirit, who already indwells us. Place God in the rightful place of the throne of our lives, and there is no time to play games of thrones. It's time to make room for the God sitting above all thrones, and this entails getting rid of the idols we worship. If you don't know a definition of what an idol is, it's anything that takes the place of worship energy, resources, money, time, talents that belong to God alone. And this includes harmful, debilitating relationships, habits, and strongholds, hindering the process God uses to mold us into the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. Get rid of anything that keeps us from forming Christ in us. But don't think this will be easy. There will be a turf war. The enemy of our souls will not go quietly into the night when we surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ. Secondly, be current in our confessions. Confessions of our sins that may be living and breathing in our lives. Prayer is to be our oxygen. Praying, believing, and waiting for a personal vintage Pentecost revival. There are three R's. I want to tell you, this sermon could have been two or three parts. So forgive me, I'm trying to stuck everything into, like putting Texas into Puerto Rico. The three R's, number one, is asking the Holy Spirit to help us remember unconfessed sin. To then renounce them, give up ownership over them, of these sins. And ask the Holy Spirit to reclaim ground given over to the sins of the enemy of the cross. Be current in our confessions. Thirdly, be aware of who we are in Jesus Christ. Be comfortable with our identity in Jesus Christ. Dr. Neil Anderson has compiled a wonderful description based on biblical verses of who we are in Christ. Let me just give you a quick example. We are Christ's friend. John chapter 15, verse 15. We are joint heirs with Christ, sharing His inheritance. Romans 8, 17. And we are seated with Christ in the heavenly places. Ephesians 2, 6. Do you believe this of this yourself today? Do you believe that these are yours, your characteristics, your identities today? Number four is a little brave. Be open to be used by God to be a threat to the domain of Satan. Be vessels of God's true love to combat the darkness of the vile hate spewed from all directions, persuasions, and political parties. Look beyond our present social, economic, or political, spiritual environments and see that our battle is not what we see with our natural eyes. We're living in times that are ripe for the harvest, a time for people to be transformed by the Lord God Most High, the awesome and great King over all the earth. It's a time of vintage Pentecost revival. And number five, and lastly, be prophetic. Not pathetic, prophetic. We are crucially needed to be proclaimers of the prophetic, forthtelling more than foretelling word of God and counsel of God in such a time as this. Imagine what would happen if every follower of Jesus Christ throughout the whole world would surrender their lives like this. We would have vintage Pentecost revival. And this is happening in Africa, in Latin America, the underground church in China, parts of Cuba, parts of Saudi Arabia, parts of Sudan. The Spirit of God is moving powerfully, and He's changing lives because the Lord Jesus Christ is coming soon. And how is the world going to change? It's going to happen because of the Church of Christ, the body of Christ, who is surrendered and submitted to the move of Christ so that His power can be throughout the nation and that there be life change. Folks, we can't put this power into anybody's life. We just point to the one who can. We point to the one who can change people's lives. And I want to encourage us today, let us embrace vintage Pentecost revival. As our worship team comes to close our worship service today, I want to encourage you today. I want to pray for us today. Perhaps today you've been thinking there's been something missing in my life. Something has been dry in my walk with Christ. Something has been missing. Folks, perhaps the Spirit of God has been chewing and chomping at the bits, waiting for you to let Him go and do what He needs to do in your life and in my life. So as our worship team closes, I want to pray for us today. Could we close our eyes right now and ask the Lord for a movement of His upon our lives, upon our families, upon the society that we live in? Father, in the name of Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, We thank you. We trust you. We love you, Father. And Father, today I pray that you would open the floodgates of your Spirit in our souls, in our spirit, and in our bodies. Forgive us that we are horrible landlords of the Spirit of God. Lord, we entertain the Spirit of God, but we allow so many things in and out of our lives that don't please him. And so, Father, today I pray, let vintage Pentecost revival roll us over, oh God, like a 18-wheeling truck, and change us and transform us. Humble us, oh God, that we can be used by you today to be change agents in this society that needs Jesus Christ so badly. We ask this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you are in need of prayer today, as our worship team is closing our service, I'm going to be here in the front wanting to pray for you if you'd like that today.
Would you stand?
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. Where you are, Lord, holiness is Christ in me. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Righteousness.
going to sing the chorus one more time. I just invite you to think about those things that we need to remember. Ask the Holy Spirit to remind you what to confess, to remember, to renounce, and to reclaim.
Lord, I need you.
Excuse me.
Good morning and welcome to Lakeview. Thank you for worshiping with us today.
If this is your first time here, please stop by the welcome table after the service to say hello and fill out a connection card to stay in touch.
I'm Tara.
And I'm Heather.
And we have been called to train hearts and move bodies to glorify God.
We are certified Revelation Wellness Fitness instructors. Revelation Wellness's mission is to love God, get healthy, be whole, and love others.
We offer group fitness classes for everyone, right here at church. No matter what your fitness level is, you are welcome.
Our classes are a mix of cardio, strength, stretching, adapted to your level of skill.
We have fun, we laugh, we pray, and we soak in God's word. This community has been such a blessing beyond what each of us could have ever imagined.
We love hearing stories of people growing in physical and spiritual health through Uniquely You. Here's just one of the many stories we could share.
Good morning. We would like to tell you about the Revelation Wellness Fitness Ministry we joined through Lakeview Church. The human body is no fluke of evolution's process. It is God's design and handiwork. It is His masterpiece given to us for use to honor Him. 1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20 tells us that we don't own our own bodies. Our bodies were bought with a price to house the Holy Spirit, to be a channel through which He can work. So caring for our bodies is a responsibility we owe to God, to keep them healthy and useful for as long as possible.
Listening to Rick, perhaps you're saying, it's too late for me to get fit or back into shape again. I was just like you. I reluctantly went to just one class, but now go as often as possible. Each of the 4 weekly classes is unique, no 2 the same. Each exercise is offered with 2, sometimes 3 variations, depending on your fitness level. We begin and end with prayer and a short study, which is an encouragement and always a blessing. Heather and Tara are incredible leaders, and we thank them so much. Our class is a blooming community, and we would love for you to join us.
The schedule is online at Lakeview Central or Lakeview Central kiosk in the cafe.
Our worship gathering is about to end, but we're looking forward to saying hello over a cup of coffee and a bagel.
Please stick around and say hi to someone new, and stop at the prayer room if you'd like to ask someone to pray with you.
Thanks for worshiping with us at Lakeview this morning, and have a great week.
Good morning, church. We must give a thanksgiving to my brother Milton for that powerful message that he gave. Thank you, my brother. And for the veterans in our midst, let's give a standing ovation to them for the sacrifices that they have made for us. Please stand up and just give them a standing ovation. Thank you. Please remain standing as we pray. But first, let's continue this service with the offering. We know there is a box by the door for those who are here and have something to give for our church. Please do. Those at home, you know what to do by mail. And please do that. For the guests in our midst today, I'm not going to ask you to give. But if you can, you can. You can. You can give us. Okay? So thank you. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for who you are. The master of the universe. The creator of the heavens and the earth. Father, there is nothing impossible for you. All things are possible for you. And master, we are told that all things are possible for us that believe. Father, we ask that you fill this sanctuary with your Holy Spirit. Everyone here today, Lord God, those who are unable to make it, fill our hearts, our minds, our souls with your Holy Spirit. Our homes with your Holy Spirit. Where we work with your Holy Spirit. Father, you are the God of light. You shine your light through each and every one of us today. That wherever we go, we reflect the image of Christ. Yes, we are going to face trials. But with you, all things are possible and we can overcome because you are the overcoming God. We thank you. Father, we bring every need to you this morning. Individual needs, family needs, whatever needs we have, Father, we ask you to meet us at our moments of need. You said in your word that you are our refuge and our strength, a very present help in times of trouble. And Father, that you meet our needs according to your glorious riches through Christ Jesus. So we believe that all things are possible for you, Lord God, that every need we have today has been taken care of by you and you alone. That's why we are here, because you are our God and Master. Fill us with your Holy Spirit for the revival that my brother is calling us to do. It's not through our power, it's not through our mind, but by your Spirit. So Master, fill us until we overflow with your Holy Spirit. Fill us with your resurrection power. That same power that raised Jesus from the grave. Master, fill us with your glorious power. Fill us with the love of Christ until we are filled to every measure in the fullness of you, Lord, our God. As we live here today, let us not depart from your presence, but remaining in your presence. For Father, you are the God whose eyes are on your children and your ears open to our cause. So we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise today, tomorrow, and forever in Jesus' name.